Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You may be seated. I'd like to welcome everybody here this afternoon, and on behalf of Bryan's family, I would like to thank you for your attendance here today to honour and to celebrate Bryan's life. The family understands that many of you have travelled some long distances to be here, and they are most grateful. My name is Murray Patchett, and I have known Bryan and the Haeusler family for 35 years. And as both a friend and a minister of the gospel, and along with the team from Midwest Funerals, I've been invited to lead us through this service for Bryan. Firstly, may I offer my heartfelt condolences to you, Verna, and to Megan and Matthew, Philip and Terry, Judith, Carolyn and Justin, and to your families on the loss of your husband, father, father-in-law and grandfather. I want to give my condolences too to Bryan's siblings, Roger, Vic, Beth, Graham and Trevor, and to your families. Before I go any further, could I ask you, if you haven't done so already, if you wouldn't mind making sure your mobile phones are turned to silent or off. Thank you. I'd like to invite Judith, Bryan's daughter, to come and lead us in the opening prayer. Thanks, Judith.
Loving God, we thank you for Bryan, our loving husband, father, Poppy, and brother. We thank you for his quiet ways, his laugh, his guidance, and the example that he has set for us to work hard and love the Lord. We rest in the reassurance that Dad is now rejoicing in the glory of the Father and celebrating his new life in your presence, free from illness and pain. We know Dad is smiling down on us. The time we had with Dad here on earth is just a fleeting moment compared to the eternity he will live in heaven with our Lord Jesus, where we will one day join him and be together forever. Amen.
Bryan's brother Vic will now recite an Aussie version of Psalm 23, and who better to do it than Vic?
Thanks, Murray. It's penned by Ree Wells, this version of the 23rd Psalm, or Aussie version. There's quite a few Aussie versions of the 23rd Psalm, I can assure you. The Lord is my jackaroo. I shall not want for anything. He makes me lie down in sunburnt pastures. He leads me beside quiet billabongs. He guides me along stock routes of righteousness for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of drought, bushfires and floods, I will fear no disaster. For you are my constant mate. Your stock whip and 22, they comfort me. You knock me up a feed in the boss's shearing shed. You give me some golden syrup and damper. My belly overflows with tea. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the homestead of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.
How Aussie is that? I'm going to ask you if you wouldn't mind to stand, and we're going to sing the chorus, Because He Lives.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my heart.
What an amazing truth. If you'd like to be seated, thank you. I'm going to ask Brian's eldest grandchild, Harry, who's going to lead us now in the Lord's Prayer. Thanks, Harry.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thanks, Harry. We're now going to have the first eulogy, so I'm going to call on Philip to come and speak for the family. Thanks.
Thanks, Mike. We're here today to celebrate the life of Bryan Pearce Haeusler, my dad. I want to thank everyone for coming today. My family very much appreciate you all being here. Dad was born on the 1st of July 1940 at Jamestown Hospital in South Australia to loving parents Joyce and Harry. He was the second of six children. Dad would spend his first 15 years growing up in Hornsdale with his sister and four brothers, Roger, Vic, Graham, Beth and Trevor. Being a bit on the short side, he was affectionately known as Shorty. I'm not too sure he ever liked that nickname, but it certainly fit. In Hornsdale, Dad went to school and spent much time working on the family farm. Even from a young age, all he wanted to do was be a farmer and run his own place. When Dad was 15, his parents picked up the whole family and relocated to Three Springs. Here, his parents hoped to provide a better chance for their children to achieve their dreams of running their own farms. And remarkably, they did just that. Shortly after coming to Western Australia, Dad finished schooling in year 10 and began working full-time on the family farm at Fairfield. Dad did not have a lot of hobbies. Farming was enough for him, but he was an excellent tennis player and had much success in the local competitions here in Three Springs. And even when Dad wasn't farming, he was still growing things. He loved having a little veggie patch and would take much pride in growing his own produce. Dad's homemade beetroot and stewed fruit were the best. Dad was a devout Christian and always attended church and made time to pray and reflect with God. It was through this devotion that at the age of 30, he met his true love and future wife, Verna. They met when Mum attended the home church gathering that was run by his parents. He stole her heart with his winning smile, and it was the start of a beautiful relationship that would last for 51 years. Mum and Dad married on the 8th of January, 1972. They would move to the Haeusler family home and take over running Fairfield in partnership with Graham and Barbara. They would live here and bring up a family for the next 34 years. After marriage, the start of their family was not too far behind. The first of Dad's four children was Megan in 1974. Then possibly Dad's greatest achievement of all time came when he welcomed his first and only son, me, in 76, Judith in 78, and Carolyn in 81. That last gap seems a bit off. Whoopsie. Growing up, we had all that a kid could wish for. Dad would take us out on the farm where we would help out, sometimes even willingly, with the sheep work, shearing, picking stumps, seeding and harvesting. We all loved riding in the tractor on Dad's knee. He was always happy to have us kids around to help, like the time I helped park the tractor right through the back of the shed. Dad took it very well and just got on with sorting it out. The one thing about Dad was he was a hard worker and I never saw him stop. After more than 50 years of farming, which Dad was very proud of, he was finally growing weary of working the land, and in 2006 he retired from the farm. He and Mum moved to Mandurah, where he was able to enjoy time pottering around the garden, growing his veggies and travelling around Australia to visit with his grandchildren. We took so much joy in watching Poppy and his grandchildren and the love and attention he gave them. It was time for Dad to enjoy a well-earned rest and embrace retirement. Dad's final years were not so kind. He did not get to fully enjoy his golden years. For the past 7 years, Dad has suffered from the effects of dementia, but these last years are not how we will remember Dad. We remember Dad for his big smile, hearty laugh, and gentle ways. I do want to thank the staff and carers at Nazareth House who did their best to ensure that these last years were as comfortable for Dad as possible. And I also want to thank Mum, who has always stayed by Dad's side and has been his constant companion and comparer. Thank you, Mum. You're awesome. Dad was a man of few words, but he always was there for us and was a rock of support if we ever needed rescuing. He kept us in line, taught us to be good people, and we are going to miss him. I love you, Dad. You can rest easy now.
And the meals we used to have around the table, he had a good appetite as well. So, Vic, would you like to come and to share some memories of your brother? Thanks.
Thank you. Sorry, Phil, I'm going to repeat a bit of yours, but never mind. I'll mess it up properly if I try and dodge it, I reckon. Bryan was a quiet and humble person. I shared the same bedroom with him for quite a few years. His side was always clean and tidy. Mine was the opposite. He should have told me to get my act together, but he didn't. He was no way a stirrer. A lady we went to school with 70 years ago said to me a week or so ago that she remembered Bryan as a quiet boy with a gorgeous smile. As Phil said, we moved to West Australia in 1955 and he completed his education here in Three Springs. I'm going to add to Phil's sport in saying that he played a bit of football, and I happened to be talking to Graham Bastian before the service and he said he can remember having a kick around the footy oval with Bryan, playing with Bryan. I'd forgotten about that, but he wasn't the fastest bloke on the oval by any means, but he didn't kick a bad sort of a left foot droppy. And I'll tell you younger blokes how to do that later on. Not that I know. As Phil said, he was good at tennis. He had a lot of fun playing a fair bit of tennis, and that was good for him. But the one thing that he excelled at, and he only ever did once or twice, was clay pigeon shooting. I was amazed to see him out at Rogers Farm one day where the bloke rocked up with a trap, hardly missing a clay. Chung, chung, bang, bang. And he'd never, to my knowledge, picked up a shotgun. Roger was the fox shooter with his single shot greener 12 gauge, not Bryan. And it was quite remarkable. Pity he didn't get involved with the club out here in East Three Springs. He began his farming career with working on Fairfield with Roger and Dad, and he was quite strong, as Phil said. He was the presser shearing time, and the Ajax wool press would click just as quickly at the end of the stroke as what it did the beginning, except perhaps for the last press, but he could really make an Ajax wool press talk. As Phil said, his name was Shorty, and I reckon it probably should have been Muscles. He was a great worker and a very good example. I just want to give you one example of him and I working together. This photo was taken in 1956. You won't see it very well, but we've harvested some self-sown oats at the very eastern edge of Fairfield. Murray McKay's property is the other side of that bush of line there, that line of bush there. And we rep 298 bags. There's some of them. And with the two headers. By the way, that's Graham's head, you won't see it, on top of the box at the brand new Shearer DS header. Roger and Bryan are emptying the box. And Graham's up there overseeing the exercise, I'm sure. He's shaking his head right now. Anyhow, Bryan and I were given the job of sowing this 298 bags of oats, and that was a good idea. He was a pretty good bag sower, and I'd love a drink of water. Can you? Could you just, we got stuck into sowing these bags, and when we'd got most of them done, we had about 20-odd bags left, we had a bit of a tally up, and it was easier to keep a tally of the number you sowed because the stack was, as two headers, was started and then moved out like that, and you started sowing one that end and one that end. He was that end and I was that end, except it didn't quite work because we got 20-odd left and we had a count up and we looked at one another. And he said, "I'm going to go for 200. And I said, "I'm going for 100. Anyhow, you guessed it. He got the 200 and I got 98. I enjoyed working with him, Dad and Roger, and later Graham and Trevor at Fairfield and Wanranooka. And then developing a block out west of Three Springs as well. In 1973, we had a farm each, and the partnership of E.H. Haeusler and Sons was dissolved. For 27 years, I'm not sure whether my years are going to add up to Phil's, but for 27 years, Graham and Bryan combined to work Fairfield, and then they later acquired half a bin dairy and Lakeview. In 2000, that partnership dissolved and Bryan then ran half of Fairfield and Lakeview by himself. Well, with Ferner and Phil. There was no doubt about it that he was very proud of a very good flock of sheep that he ran. He had a good line of sheep and bought a little bit of wool for you, Shorty. A South Australian sheep and wool consultant once said that Bryan's flock was amongst the better flocks that he had dealt with during his career as a sheep and wool consultant. One day, while he was checking his sheep out in the Lake Country, he did have a bit of a mishap. He was chuffing around on his motorbike and cruising through the bush, and all of a sudden a fair-sized roo shot out from behind a tree, made a leap at him and clean flattened him off the motorbike, knocked him flying. Anyway, he shook himself and got himself up and got the motorbike up and away he went, quite happy. No harm done, but it was a little bit exciting for a couple of seconds for him. When seasons permitted, he grew some pretty good crops and was meticulous in the way he operated and maintained machinery. The last 2 years before he retired in 2005 were not overly kind to him. He had a terrible bad luck in falling from a 15-foot tank stand. And he also contracted a bug in his blood, a blood infection, I suppose you'd call it, probably from a cut in his hand cleaning out a trough, they seem to calculate. And that was pretty tough because he was getting around with a walking stick, and it was pretty hard for him. I was able to help him finish his last harvest, and I was pleased that I could do that. But it did shock me one day when we'd emptied the fuel bins, and he turned to me and said, "Will you lift the fuel bins up? I haven't got the strength to do it anymore." Ten years ago, he was diagnosed with the dreaded Alzheimer's, as Phil mentioned, and spent these last 7 years in Nazareth House. No doubt, quite a traumatic time for him, and very difficult for his beautiful family as well. Several years ago, while I visited him, I got talking to him, as I did, I talked too much, and he was lying there, and we'd just sort of finished harvest, and I'd been down at Fairfield helping Christian and Graham with their harvest, and I was rabbiting on about how I'd just driven this brand new 45-foot John Deere header, and rattling on about the Chaser Bend driver. I think he was a little Irish bloke that year, and he shaved a SEC pole at one stage and gave it a bit of a nudge. I don't know whether Christian knew about that. But anyhow, it didn't do any harm. He was a great lad. Anyhow, I finally paused a bit, and as was normal, Bryan didn't respond. Hadn't done for several years, and I reckon he'd have been... If he could have spoken to me, he would have said, "Yeah, that's all good. That was good. But do you reckon it might have been better with a New Holland header?" I saw him last two or three weeks ago, and I chatted to him and stayed for quite a bit longer than what I normally did, because I've had the feeling that it was the last time I'd see him. And I ended up telling him that Christian had bought Lakeview. And I doubt if he heard me. He was in a dying state. But if he had of, I'm sure he would have been pleased about that. Bryan, I want to commend you for living a life that gave Mum and Dad much pride. You were a loving husband to Verna, father to Philip, or Megan, Philip, Judith and Carolyn, and Poppy to your eight beautiful grandkids. Unfortunately, most of the young ones, or the young ones, didn't ever get to know you or you them. He was a terrific brother to Roger, Beth, Graham and Trevor and me. And we give thanks for all those blessings. Oh, God, sorry. In the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 16, we read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his own one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Bryan believed that God loved Bryan and gave his Son for Bryan, and therefore assuring Bryan of eternal life. 12 days ago, his life here on earth ended. And then as his soul entered heaven, the words Jesus said to him would have gone something like this: "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come into the room that I have prepared for you." And I just want to close by saying I think it's important that every one of us here today believe that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you.
We've got an open mic now, so I'm going to invite those of you who'd like to share to come forward.
We have received some memories of Bryan from people who could not be here today. The first is from John Staker, one of Bryan's cousins from South Australia. Thanks for the invite to give a tribute to Bryan. Oh, Baba. Being an only child, the Haeuslers, my cousins, were more like a sister and brothers to me. As children, we spent many happy times together. Before leaving for the West, Bryan and I boarded at Mama's in Jamestown. Notably, I cannot remember a cross word between us. In his family, Bryan stood out as the quiet one. He never sought the limelight. He was always thoughtful, caring, and yet enterprising enough to break with family cropping tradition and set up a nucleus flock within the Australian Merino Society guidelines for an improvement program. Bryan was reliable, constant, and loved his family and his little dogs. Farewell, Bryan. You were a true gentleman. Love from John. The second is from Evelyn Parry, a very good friend of Bryan and Verna's from Mandurah. Bryan was a very quiet and gentle man. I enjoyed my times with him when Verna and her friends would be working up in her craft room. I would sit with him, make his favourite cup of tea, and chat with him. I will always treasure those times. I admired Bryan for his strong Christian values and for his love he showed for Verna, his children, grandchildren, and his little dogs. Bryan will be greatly missed, but remembered with joy. Thank you.
Today's opening hymn, the day that Bryan passed, was the first thing I heard, because he lives, and I knew just when that first come to me, I knew Bryan had gone. We knew it wasn't going to be long from the last time I talked to Verna. Bryan was very special to me because he was the first brother I ever had, being the oldest of four girls, and it was so wonderful. He wouldn't say much. He was very quiet, as everybody knows, but boy, that smile of his. He didn't have to say anything. It was a smile that spoke for him, and I'm sure everybody in this room has felt that smile. I also know that his children, a lot of them have inherited that smile. And I know that because he did live, and because he lived for the Lord, that that is exactly where he is. He has found peace, and he is waiting for each one of us who knows the Lord to join him. And I just praise the Lord for giving me the opportunity to thank him for putting Bryan in our lives. Amen.
If there's anyone here that doesn't know me, I am Beth Gooch, Bryan's sister. Bryan was the most humble, quietest man I have ever known, which made him the most awesome brother. I can't really say he's the best brother because I've got five best brothers. Now, I'm going to tell you a little story. I've put this to Verna and Megan to make sure it's okay. I tell this story. It's an unusual story. Mum told me once, or probably more than once, when she was in imminent labour with Bryan in the Jamestown Hospital, the nursing staff phoned the doctor to tell him to come quick, because he was at the doctor's surgery seeing his patients, because, you know, it was about to happen. And he said, tell her to hold back, because he couldn't, you know, he wasn't there. And I'm sure every woman in this room who has given birth wouldn't like to hear that, because you're what, out? Anyway, I think he got there in time for the birth. But Mum always said, I think that's why Bryan held back all his life. And he did. He sort of stood back, you know, didn't go forward. And he sort of, yeah, hung back all his life. That's just the way he was. Now, Vic mentioned the sowing of wheat bags. Well, not only did he sow wheat bags, Mum actually taught him to knit. And he, when we were still in South Australia, he knitted me a doll's jumper. It was beautiful. He was so meticulous. And of course, as Vic mentioned, another attribute of his was being neat and tidy. He has mentioned the bedroom. I used to help Mum with the washing and the ironing and take the clothes to the bedroom, of which they shared. Sorry, Vic, but Bryan's was always very neat and tidy and clean. But not so much yours, I'm sorry. Oh, righto. Now, Bryan and I know, the boys had the common interest of the farm. Bryan and I, our common interest was tennis, of course. Actually, we played in a few tournaments together. We did pretty well because he was, as Vic said, he was a good player, very good player. In his early years at Nazareth House, I play pennant tennis every Thursday in Geraldton. I still do. And I used to go up and visit him. And, of course, I'd talk tennis. And his response was, did ya? Did ya? And he would respond with that. And, of course, that unmistakable laugh of his. And then, as years went on, I'd still talk tennis, but then there would just be the smile. I also did a couple of times one weekly tennis coaching sessions, and I'd finish just in time to feed him lunch. And he was amazing. He absolutely loved his food. He'd open his mouth for that mouthful every time. He'd be ready for it, ready for the next mouthful all the time. He loved his food, even if it was vitamised. The only regret, of course, is that I didn't do more for him. But, of course, you know, with time, distance, other commitments, it was hard. But I would have loved to have done more for him. Now, I've actually written a bit of a poem for Bryan. It's entitled Bryan. B is for beloved brother, second son of the five. R is for respect I have held for you all my life. Y is for you were the quiet one, forever tidy and neat. A is for always with a smile, such a pleasure to meet. N is for now you are at peace with God, reunited with Mum and Dad.
I'm the youngest bloke out of a lot of them. Thanks to our best sister for her little presentation. I just want to share an early memory that I had of Bryan. When I was in about year 6 or 7, I used to ride my bike 4 miles to catch the school bus, because the school bus used to call in at home at about 7:20 in the morning and have a 70-kilometre round trip to get to school. So if I got on my bike at about 7:40, so that gave me 30, 40 minutes at home extra, I'd ride down to the Prinsbury Road. We were always shearing while school was on, and the shearers never worked on weekends, so I never had a chance to see much shearing. I'd sneak down there sort of when they first started, and in 10 minutes I'd have to be on me treadley up to the Catsa school bus. Anyway, one day I was sort of in that sort of mood. I wanted to be in the shearing ship. So I got on my bike at about 7:30, a bit later probably. Rode slowly down to the school bus, very slowly. And I was real happy to see old Corvant Veer driving his school bus cross in front of me off to Three Springs. I thought, now what will I do? It's too far to ride my bike to Three Springs. I might as well just turn around and go home, knowing full well that nobody would have time to run me to school, because Mum did all the cooking for the shearers and Dad was busy mustering sheep and what have you. So I turned my bike around and pedalled hell for leather back home and spent the whole day in the shearing shed, sitting at the end of the board watching the shearers. And as Vic said, whenever I heard one click on that wool press, my attention would be drawn to Bryan. He could go nearly quicker than the eye could see with those levers on the wool press. And then smoko time would come. Well, Shorty's job was to press the wool, count the sheep out after every run, and brand them. So the morning tea would be laid out, or the smoker would be laid out for the shearers and the shed hands and us blokes. And of course Shorty would be out counting out and branding. So by the time he'd finished all that, it was probably 5 minutes to go before we start the next run. During the week, Tamara asked, what was Shorty's favourite smoker? Well, we'll probably never know. He just had what was left. So I had a really good relationship with Shorty. We'll see you later, mate.
Is there anybody else that would like to share?
We've heard some interesting stories of Bryan's life from those who knew him the best, through the eulogies and also through the family testimonies. But now we have the opportunity to share some memories of Bryan in a photo tribute. So if you would like to direct your attention to the screen, thank you.
Thank you.
picture paints a thousand words. There's a lot of good memories there. I'm going to ask Judith to come and to read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Thanks, Judith.
One Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to 18. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words.
An encouraging portion of scripture. And as I said earlier, I have known the Haeusler family since, we were trying to work it out, 1985 or 1986. Once a month for 5 or 6 years, I would come up to Three Springs and spend time in the with the church and with the family, spending those weekends, sometimes a week at a time, with Bryan and Verma and the family. They became close and firm friends. Some of the best memories of my life from Three Springs. So it's an honour and a privilege to share some thoughts today as we farewell Bryan. And in this portion of scripture that Judith just read, Paul was writing to a community that was grieving over loved ones who had passed away. Those that were left behind were devastated, and they were left with many questions, as may some of you be today. Paul deals with these issues head on. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. Paul's not suggesting that we should not grieve, or that grief is wrong, not at all. To lose a loved one is to lose a part of oneself. It calls for radical and painful adjustments, which sometimes may take time and may take months. And in these times, the struggle is to bring our faith and our emotions together. The death of a loved one deprives us of their company. So grief is both natural and it is appropriate. We need to be careful to respect the grieving process, and everybody does it differently. And we should never deny that grieving process. But for us here today, the grieving has been prolonged. Because Bryan's illness has separated him from us. Maybe not physically, but certainly emotionally and communicatively, we've been separated from him over these past 8 years. We've been separated from a person we loved, even though he's there. I remember the last time I saw Bryan was just before family moved from Falcon to Geraldton. And I'd been to see the family 2 or 3 times in the previous months, and this one time, and most of you probably know, if you knew Bryan, that he loved his footy and he enjoyed the Eagles. Sorry if everybody else, but he enjoyed watching the Eagles play, and that was mutual, so that was, we got on well in many different levels. And I remember sitting there talking to him, And it pained me that, in a sense, he wasn't there. That man that I got to know, that strong, quiet man that laughed easily, and he had an interesting laugh as well. He was no longer there. And so while we still had his physical presence, Bryan was separated from us at that time. Today, however, I want to speak a word of comfort and hope, because you have had to endure a long and painful journey as you watched an insidious condition rob Bryan of his humanity and ultimately of his life. And even when death ends prolonged suffering, it still causes grief, but it's a different grief, but it's a grief nonetheless. So it's a grief upon grief. And we need to understand the reality of that. It's okay to grieve. And it's okay to grieve in your way. And it's okay to grieve over time, as long as it takes for you. But Christians, having said that, do not need to be people who grieve without hope. Christian grief is tempered by the reality of the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Hallelujah. Sorry, I'll get carried away. It's okay. And God's love surrounded Bryan from his younger days. He was a man of faith. But then, in the early 80s, probably around 1984, 1985, Bryan had a deeper encounter with Christ through a Full Gospel Businessmen's meeting here in Three Springs. I think probably most of the Haeusler men were there for that meeting. God did something deeper in Bryan's life, and that faith that was already there became even deeper and stronger. And as much as God had given him a strength through his life, God was then the center of many years of Bryan and Verna's marriage. God's love surrounded and upheld him, even as he lost touch with reality over these past few years. God was still present. God's love was the source of Bryan's hope. It was the source of his hope even when he wasn't aware of that hope. And it's the source of our hope today if we know Christ. Through our hope in Christ, we are given comfort and strength. And as Paul explains in that portion that Judith just read, we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Jesus died and rose again. And in so doing, he defeated death once and for all. And in 1 Corinthians 15:55, Paul exclaims, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" It's also a mockery of death. Paul encourages us to not let our grief be sharpened by worrying about those who have died with faith in Jesus. The reality for us that are gathered here today is that Bryan has tasted victory. And that's good news. He's okay now. He's with Jesus. Metaphorically, however, Paul says he's fallen asleep. His death, in reality, is only temporary. Through Jesus' death and resurrection, those who have died having faith in him will rise again too. This body, this temporal facility may be dead, but this earthly body is not what makes Bryan, Bryan. Just as the same as this does not make you, you. Our true nature, that which glorifies God and exemplifies the wonder of our Creator, is that part of us which is imperishable, that inner man. And it is this truth that gives all believers hope, and it's a hope that will never die. Death is not the end. Some ways it's just the beginning. Our life on this earth is short and temporary, but our life with Christ is eternity. It is endless. There is an amazing future that God has promised for us. And this promise is fulfilled for Bryan. His spirit is now alive with Christ in heaven. The debilitating condition which affected Bryan in the first few years of his life have been transcended, and he is fully restored, fully reunited, in fact, with all those who have gone before. But also, as Paul points out in this portion of Scripture, one day Jesus will return to this messed up, hurting, broken world, and he's going to restore the whole of creation to its former perfect glory. And there's going to be an amazing reunion, because as Paul writes in this portion of Scripture, we also believe that God will bring with Jesus those who died while believing in him. That's Bryan. Those Christians who have died are now in God's care, and they will not be missing out at all when Christ returns. They're coming with him. They're with their Saviour now, who lived and died for them, but they're coming back with him to meet those of us who are still alive. What an incredible reunion that's going to be. We don't know when it's going to happen. And it may be that it will happen for some of us in our lifetime. But that's the reality for Christian family and friends here today. We will be seeing Bryan again. Bryan fully restored. Bryan fully cognitive. He will know you and you will know him. And most wonderful of all is the promise, we're all going to be with the Lord forever. One day we will be where Jesus is. People talk about awesome. That's awesome. It's a word that is so often misused, but in this case, that is the awesome reality that we are confronted with today. One day, we will meet Bryan face to face with Jesus. In the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 3 and 4, we are told that when we are in that heavenly place with Christ and with Bryan, there will be no more suffering, no more sin, and death will have been overcome, swallowed up in Christ's victory, as we've already mentioned. This is great news. It's not a lot of much news in the newspaper today. In fact, we were talking about it, Verna and I, on the way down here today. I don't like reading the newspaper because it has a certain bias. But this is the news we need to hear. This is good news. Jesus has given us hope in the face of death. And Bryan knew that hope. And we can't wait to be reunited with him one day. Is that right? Can't wait. And this great news is the truth that we need to hear over and over and over again in these times of uncertainty. And even more so in the days, weeks and months to come, when we ache for Bryan and other loved ones from whom we've been separated, when the silences are deafening, where the memories can be overwhelming, and the things that we've enjoyed simply aren't the same anymore, because nothing will be the same anymore. We may wonder, when will the pain end? When will it go away? But this passage gives us an answer. The pain will end for good when Jesus returns, when everything will be made perfect again. And Bryan's in that place of perfection right now. He's at peace and he's glorifying the God of his salvation. He's speaking as he has not been able to speak in these last few years. He is enunciating the glory of God with words that he has not been able to utter for these past few years. He's with Jesus. He's in the arms of the God who loves him and who has wiped away every tear from Brian's eye. He's home. He's home where all true believers belong. That is our hope. And yet, as hard as it may be with some difficult days ahead, the same God is also with us here today, ready with his, may I say it, heavenly handkerchief, offering to wipe away our tears, to hold us in his arms, and to allow us to cry on his shoulder. And be prepared to do that. When you feel the time is right, when you feel it's necessary, do it. God wants to comfort you. He is known as our comforter. He's whispering to us, I'm with you. I will always be with you. You'll never be alone. So let's allow Jesus to comfort us. And let's be Jesus to each other and comfort each other as well. Let's not lose hope. Jesus is alive. He's defeated death. And he will come back again to take us to himself. He gives us hope, love and life has won. Bryan has won. And we too will win when we meet with Jesus face to face. And I believe Bryan would encourage us today to place your faith in Jesus Christ. As we've heard, Bryan was a man of few words. He had this quiet strength, but he was a man of faith. And when we sat down and we talked about Jesus, he loved talking about Jesus. He didn't talk with everybody a lot. I was privileged in some ways probably to have that relationship with him where he probably spoke with me. I've got to be careful how I say this. Probably a little bit more than others because of the relationship we built over the years. But he has a strong, firm foundation in his Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. And I'm sure that he will encourage us today to put our faith in Christ so that you too can have the assurance of resurrection and eternal life with Jesus Christ in his heavenly kingdom. And if there is anybody here today who doesn't have that assurance, I know Verna and family would love to talk to you. I would love to talk to you. If you want to talk to me sometime this afternoon, I'll endeavour to answer any questions that you may have about Jesus, life, death and eternity, that place where Bryan is already at rest and where we have the opportunity one day to meet him face to face. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the love that you have shown toward us by giving your one and only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to take our sins, to take the burden of the punishment so that we may have that eternal place in heaven when we surrender our life to you. Father, I thank you for Bryan's life and for his testimony and the testimonies that we've heard today about his faith. And Father, we look forward to that day that we're going to meet him with you face to face. But I pray, Lord, in the intervening period that you would comfort us, that you would strengthen us, and that the memories that we have would be memories of the good times that we were able to share with Bryan. And for those, Lord, who do not know you today, I pray that somehow, some way, you would speak to hearts, just show them the love of God, that they too may recognize the hope and the future that is found in the Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. So, Father, we just thank you for this short opportunity that we've had today to talk about Bryan, to talk about you. And, Lord, as we leave here this afternoon and go to the graveside, I pray that the scriptures and the words we've heard today through testimony, through through the eulogies may sit strong in our heart and just remind us of the love that you have for us. And we ask this in the most precious and blessed name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to invite Verna to come and to share the reading from Isaiah. And family, if you like, I don't mind.
Yep. Nah, that's all right, I'll read it from here, Mo. Isaiah 61, verse 1 and verse 3. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to console those who mourn, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garments of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Amen.
I love to see family. Now, after today's proceedings, Verna and the family would like to invite you to join them in the procession to Bryan's burial at the Three Springs Cemetery. And for those of you that are unable to walk up to the burial site, feel free to follow the procession in your own vehicles. And as you leave here just now, there will be cold water available at the back of the church, but there will also be some water available at the cemetery, so please help yourselves. Then at the conclusion of the burial service, you're invited to join together with the family and friends for afternoon tea in the town hall, a whole one block away, in the red room, and there's giving thanks to the Three Springs Hockey Club for being prepared to arrange that for the family. So if you wouldn't mind standing, I'm going to close in prayer. Then we're going to sing the chorus In Christ Alone. And as we start singing that chorus, I ask the pallbearers to come forward at that time, and we'll prepare to take Bryan to his final resting place. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that you know every one of us. You know the hairs on our head, you number them. So, Father, we surrender ourselves to you today. We surrender ourselves to what has taken place, this confronting reality that this is the end for all of us in our future. Help us, Lord, to deal with it, but more importantly, help us, Lord, to be prepared for it. As we say farewell from Bryan at this point in time to take him to his final place of rest, Lord, may we just again hold in our heart the reality that one day we're all faced, not in a morbid way, but Lord, in a hope that is found in you. And we bless you for that in Jesus' name. So we're going to sing In Christ Alone. Thank you. So if we'd like to take the memorials from...
In Christ alone, my hope is found. John 14, verses 1 to 4. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going.
Our loss is Bryan's gain, which can also be a cause for rejoicing and thankfulness for us in the midst of our sorrow. Because as we shared earlier, God has conquered death through his Son, Jesus Christ. And because of what death means to those who have placed their trust in Jesus Christ, it is actually a beginning. We believe that this grave is just a resting place for Bryan's body. For when Jesus returns, his body will be raised up. And as I shared, I'm going to read the whole scripture of 1 Corinthians 15, or not the whole scripture, but a few verses. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 to 57. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. Then the saying that is written will come true, death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And this is a tangible representation today that Bryan has won the victory, that although his mortal remains will be placed in the earth, there is going to come a day when he will be raised to meet Jesus in the air. We now come to a time of committal. Just prior to committing Bryan to the ground, once he's been laid to rest, you're all invited to take a sprig of rosemary and to farewell him by casting it into the grave. Rosemary is the traditional herb of remembrance. And we read in Shakespeare's Hamlet, there's rosemary. That's for remembrance. Pray, love, remember. And remembrance because once you have handled rosemary, the aroma lingers, reminding you in particular today of having gathered here out of honour, love and respect for Bryan. But when we do place the rosemary, the immediate family will go first, followed by Bryan's extended family, and then you, his friends. So as I say the words of committal, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through the Lord Jesus Christ, tenderly and lovingly, we commend our brother Bryan to Almighty God, and we commit his body to its resting place, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace.